Praise the Lord, believers. All things are working for my good. Travis Green, music by him. Welcome to White Plains Baptist Church Bible Study. All things are working for our good. That's good news. Great music. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, we're thankful to you for this time to study the Word of God. Bless us, fill us, inform us, help us, and strengthen us through the Word of God. Thank you and bless us. Change us in Jesus' name. Amen. We've been working through the Psalms, and tonight we're in Psalm 54. Psalm 54. We entitled this lesson, Short Prayers Work. Short Prayers Work. Now, as David pens this lament, that's the type of psalm this is, he shows that brevity in prayer emphasizes intensity in prayer. Brevity in prayer, shortness, emphasizes intensity, energy in prayer. His prayer is short and to the point, which demonstrates the immediacy of his concerns. Psalm 54 is 7 verses. He was on the run from King Saul. It's the backdrop of this, and he was running because of Saul's jealousy. David hid from Saul in the wilderness of Ziph. It was a barren desert region surrounding this city. So he was in a wilderness that surrounded Ziph. So the Ziphites told Saul where David was. They wanted not to be under his wrath, so to speak, and gave him the opportunity to capture him. So they were clearly David's enemies who sought his demise. So David turns to God with an emergent need. He prays a concise prayer on the run. His expressions are intense. His expressions are sincere. He's provided an example for all of the followers of God to use and incorporate into their lives and lifestyle. Use short prayers in dire circumstances. Pray with fire. Pray with intensity. Pray with sincerity. Short prayers, not long-winded prayers. Short ones. So pray in the immediacy of the moment. Life had become extremely difficult for David, and he turned to God with this short prayer and addressed his concerns with God with brevity and intensity. So here he is talking to God. He was concerned. The Ziphites helped Saul out. Saul was heavily on his trail. And David had an ally. It's always good to have God as your ally. He'll make a difference. I couple this psalm and this these seven verses with what James said in the New Testament. It says, confess your faults one to another and pray for one another that ye may be healed. The effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. And from there, I'm emphasizing the effectual nature and the fervent nature of prayer from a righteous person. It does much. It makes a difference. David's prayer was real and sincere. What James suggests helps us to be real. It's, of course, when we interact with each other and talk of our faults and what have you, then, of course, pray for each other that we can be healed. The fervency and the effectual nature of prayer makes a difference. So the usage of short prayers helps us knowing what to say in that moment. This is where life matters a lot or most. Learning how to pray at the blink of an eye, knowing to call on God at the moment, learning to look to God when something happens. So that's not looking to be so formal in prayer and have to be in a formal setting, but knowing how to connect with God yourself and get what you need from Him. So we see that this psalm is rich. Short prayers work. We want to unpack this psalm, and looking at the first three verses, a request for God's rescue. The first three verses. Psalm 54, the New Living, come with great power, O God, and rescue me. Defend me with your might. Listen to my prayer, O God. Pay attention to my plea. For strangers are attacking me. Violent people are trying to kill me. They care nothing for God. The first three verses, a request for God's rescue. So the psalmist asked God to display his great power and rescue him. So God has power, come with great power, were his words. So display your power before my enemies, around those who are trying to come for me and harm me. Come, it's not like God isn't present, but when we are in a situation, we use words that seem appropriate at the moment. Come, I strongly suggest, and from a theological standpoint, that God is present. God is always present, but it's a request. He's in the moment. He's facing something dire. Enemies are after him. Come with great power. Show up with great power. Display great power. Show these people that not only you're God, but I belong to you. So he prays for him to use his position. Use your position as God. Use your authority, your character, which are represented by your name. And he says, come with great power, O God. That represents, so he comes with his position. He's sovereign. He's over all. His authority. He's omnipotent. He's in charge. He's our Father. The earth is his, and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. He says, use your position, your authority, and your character represented by your name. He requests that he defend him, ask God to defend him by his valor. God is valiant. God is successful in battle. Any battle God has waged, he's won. Anytime he's gone to bat for his people, he's won. So use your valor, your mastery, your strength. He asked God to discern in verse 2 and respond to his petition. So in verse 1, we do have him asking for God's power to display it, him to ask God to use his position, his authority, and his character represented by his name. Use your valor, Lord. I know you're valiant. Your mastery is masterful. Many of us can become proficient in our work and receive accolades because of our proficiency, certificates, degrees. If you're in martial arts, you get belts, proficiency. But none of us are perfect. So when God uses his valor and his mastery, he's more than proficient. He's perfect. So when God acts, he acts precisely. So it's his mastery and his strength. So in verse 2, listen to my prayer, O God. He asks for God to discern and respond to his position, his petitions. He prays that God would pay attention to his plea. Hear me, God. Hear my words. Respond to my circumstances. He labels his attackers as strangers, although they were Jews from Ziph. So they acted like strangers. They acted like people who didn't know God and didn't know David, didn't know that David was a part of God's family. So they acted like strangers. And sometimes when people harm you who know you, you say, wow, this must be a stranger. He's acting like a stranger. So he calls them strangers, but he's asked for God's help. He says that violent people seek to take his life. People who know him became violent towards him. He says that they were not committed to God. They didn't even care for God. So it was a request for God's rescue. Come with great power. Rescue me. Come using your position, using your authority, using your character represented by your name. Come in your valor, with your mastery, with your strength. Come, dear God. Discern and respond to me. Because we can borrow the New Testament here and say, what Christ said, that God knows what we have need of before we ask. And so his request for God to discern, God already saw, God already knew, and he already knows. He knows our pitfalls, he knows our stumbles, he knows our struggles, he knows people who are around us, whether family or friends, supposed friends, supposed enemies, people we view as enemies, our real enemy is Satan. So people who come after us and make life difficult, we can ask for his rescue, and God will come masterfully and with his strength to make a difference. So we can address God in multiple ways. We can ask him to do so much. All right, verse 4 and 5, we see that as an ally and support. God is an ally and support. Those verses read, "But God is my helper. The Lord keeps me alive. May the evil plans of my enemies be turned against them. Do as you promised and put an end to them." Verses 4 and 5. So God is our ally and support. So the psalmist declares that God is his protector. That's what we should do. It's right there. "But God is my helper." He just spoke of strangers who were trying to harm him. People who were acquaintances and familiar with him, but after him, they became enemies and they sought to harm him. But his response, we should borrow and use it and make it our response to difficulty. God is my helper. He is my protector. God is my protector. He says that God is my helper and aid. And these are specific adjectives and specific ways in which God displays himself and shows himself for his people and for humanity. He's a protector. He's a helper. And he's an aid. In verse 4, he announces God is as an ally and support. He's my protector. He's my helper. He's an aid for me. He's an ally for me. And to be an ally, you got to be on God's team. You got to be a follower of God. You got to let him do, as Psalm 23 said, "Lead me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake." So he's my ally and support. And it says that God keeps him alive. It's right there in the verse. It says, "But God is my helper." And we said all these terms from Hebrew meanings: protector, helper, aid, ally, support. He said, "The Lord keeps me alive." God keeps me alive. He has the power of life and death. I know if you recall the story of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego being placed in the fire. It's an odd situation because the men who threw him in the fire were killed in process, but they ended up in the fire anyway. But when they got in the fire, the Lord was in the fire. So when you get in your situation, God is already in there. And while in there, their hairs weren't burnt. Their clothing weren't burnt. Their skin didn't scorch or burn. They didn't smell like smoke once they were out. So the fire burned those who threw them in. But when they got in there, God met them in there. So that goes along with what we're saying. God keeps, David said, God keeps him alive. So God kept them alive. God can keep us alive. So there are many, many moments when Saul was close to David and God let him get by. And David saw Saul pass by him, but God protected him. So God keeps him alive because God wanted him alive. So when God wants to keep us, he will. And then in verse 5, "May the evil plans of my enemies be turned against them." He said to God, will turn his enemy's plans against them. What they worked to harm you will work against them. What they worked to bring you down or bring you to your demise will harm them. He states that God will return the grief. He will return the hurt. He will return the sorrow, grief, hurt, sorrow that someone may cause against those persons. He asked that God would remove, totally destroy and exterminate them. And that's rough language, to ask God to harm people. But this is imprecatory language, that theological term for the psalm. And the psalm is always, or usually, and would use this kind of language, this warrior David, who'd extinguished several persons with his sword and with his abilities. He was a valiant warrior, so he believed in exterminating and destroying. And so he asked God to remove them, Lord, get them out of my way, destroy them. And I wouldn't submit that that should always be our prayers for people to be harmed. Certainly God is not our hitman. But we can ask God to protect us. And in essence, that's what this is. Protect me. Help me. And God will turn the foolishness of some who may come against you on them. He acknowledges his trust in God's faithfulness in verse 5. Do as you promise and put an end to them. I trust you. I trust what you are able to do. I trust what your word says you will do. I trust how you will handle things, how you will make life better. So we see here a request to or for God's rescue. Use your great power use your position. Use your authority. Use your character to protect me. And you know, all of that is represented by your name. So you call on God, God's name. His position is in there. You call God's name, his authority is represented. You call God's name, his character is wrapped up in there. And as you seek him, he can use his valor, his mastery, his strength. Imagine the God moving like that and making us comfortable and taking care of our well-being. But as he does that, he calls God an ally, protector, a helper, an aid, ally and support. It keeps him alive. He'll make sure that the enemy is taken care of. You and I don't have to harm anybody physically, use words to harm anybody. We don't have to do anything. God will protect us. God will help us stand. God will help us to remain faithful, and he'll help us to do well. And so what we ought to determine some words and phrases that can express our confidence during our prayers. David did that, and as we talk to God, we can borrow David's words. We can speak in our own vocabulary and from our own vernacular about who God is, how he works, how you can describe how he works. You can name incidents, various moments when God intervened and moved and helped, delivered or healed or made a difference for us and helped us go through situations and circumstances, help us face negative environments and problems. And so he will turn negatives on the people who project them. So God will help us stand. So a request for God's rescue, an ally and support. But lastly, a voluntary sacrifice in verses 6 and 7. I will sacrifice a voluntary offering to you. I will praise your name, O Lord, for it is good. for you have rescued me from my troubles and helped me to triumph over my enemies. The psalmist begins to worship God for his response to him. So when we come to God in these ways, he'll help us to be cognizant of when he's done it, when he's moved, when he's delivered, when he's healed, when he's stopped people, when he's stopped negative talk or negative actions, when he's opened doors that need to be opened, when he's closed doors that need to be closed, when he's worked. So he worshiped God for his response. And you know, when God works, when God does his valiant work, we ought to worship him. We worship him because he's God, but our response to him is what David did, is to worship him for how he intervenes. Now, our worship is not predicated on deliverance, but our response to God's actions is to say thank you. We're not manipulating God through worship for him to deliver us, but we are responding. So when God does something good, we respond. When God lifts us out of something, heals us, makes us strong, makes our lives better, we respond by saying thank you. So he voluntarily, David did, makes a promise to God because of his deliverance. He voluntarily promises to God. He makes a free will offering to God for his blessing in verse 6. Of course, there are three kinds of peace offerings or free will offerings. First, thank offerings in response to unsolicited special divine blessing. Secondly, votive or vowed offering in pursuit of making request or pledge to God. And thirdly, free will offerings spontaneously presented in worship and praise. So we can give free will offerings, thank offerings, vows, or votive offerings, making pledges, or we can give spontaneous worship and praise to God. David does this free will offering is in this sense. So it was a spontaneous praise, spontaneous worship that he gave to God. And I hope you can do that right now. You can spontaneously, just at this moment, worship God for a list of things. Can you think of a list of things, a list of deliverances, a list of blessings, a list of doors opened, a list of job opportunities, a list of ways out of trouble, a list of ways through trouble or through storms, a list over, a list under, a list around. We wouldn't have enough paper. We wouldn't have enough space, gigabytes on our devices to word process, write, or what have you. All that God has done for us. We could praise him. We could acknowledge him. We could give him what he's due because of what he's done. So our response to him is what David's, it was free will. It's not demanded. And God has made us free, free to choose. Free will is a choice. We can choose to worship God. So he says that God rescued him from his trouble. Thank you, Lord. He rescued him from his trouble. Verse 7, for you have rescued me from my troubles. The latter phrase of 6 in New Living, I will praise your name, O Lord, for it is good. For you have rescued me from my troubles. And he says how God allows him to observe how he handles his enemies. And sometimes God lets us see what happens to people who harm us, and sometimes he doesn't. It shouldn't be our goal. Our goal is to be to trust God. And people who harm us shouldn't be what's so our focus, but God should be. Let God be the target of your faith. Let God be who you interact with about difficulties. All right, it says that God saw, well, it says that he saw God defeat his enemies. And I guess that's good. He will prepare a table before us in the presence of our enemies. He'll let us feast and let our enemies see that all is well. He'll let us do well. He'll deliver us and let others see. He'll strengthen us and let others see. He'll shower blessings on us and allow others to see. He'll help us to do well in life while others watch. So we ought to focus on, my sisters and brothers, focus on the promises that you are willing to make to God, the promises that you are willing to give God now. What you're promising to let go? What would you promise to commit to? What would you promise to say to God because of his commitment, because of his faithfulness, because of the energy he uses for us? Will we promise to use our energy for him? We should think of moments to give, share, when it's neither assessed or requested. Sometimes we use the church jargon assessments. But why wait on an assessment? God is good all the time. Why don't we be a blessing, a spontaneous blessing? God will show us how to make a difference or be a difference. Rather than waiting on blessings, give blessings. Rather than asking God to shower on them on us, blessings on us, we are blessing ourselves. A voluntary sacrifice, a willingness to give your all to this God. This is a short prayer, short and concise, very well packed and prepared by this great servant of God. And we ought to mimic this method and use short prayers in our lives. And God will work for us. Prayerfully, you have got something out of this study tonight. And prayerfully, it'll make a difference in your growth. If you desire a copy, you can message me on Facebook. Message our church's page, or Dr. Johnny Johnson's page, and we'll get you a copy of this lesson. We bid you Godspeed, and I hope you can have a great night. Let's end this in prayer. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for the word. Let us absorb it. Let it make a difference in what we become for you. Thank you so much for the word taking us higher and for being our solid foundation. In Jesus' strong name, amen. God bless you.